Hello and welcome to yet another episode of the ProWorkflow X series for Photoshop, the best way to Photoshop ever. I'm your host Sid Vasanani, and in this video, I'm going to show you how to get the best out of your RAW files using an amazing blending technique involving smart objects in Photoshop. I'm going to begin in Lightroom, but you can also start directly in Adobe Camera Raw. Our goal here is to create a base image in Photoshop which retains all the RAW information. Before doing any adjustments, I'll apply the Studio Light Base preset from the ProWorkflow X set. Basically, what this does is it improves the skin tones and gives a sharpness and clarity similar to Capture One's default. The Studio Light preset works with all kind of artificially lit images, be it flash or LEDs. As a ProWorkflow X user, it is important for you to understand the intended use of these presets. The Natural Light Base preset is for portraits shot in natural light. It is very similar to the Studio preset, but with slightly more dynamic range. You can also use the HDR landscape for a further boost in the dynamic range of natural light. For a more stylized look, there is Earthy Matte Base and Cinematic Film Base. And you can find these exact same presets in Adobe Camera Raw in the Presets tab right here. For images to be edited in Photoshop, use either the Clean Studio Light or the Natural Light Base preset. Okay, so once you apply the Base Raw preset, and adjust the basic exposure in Lightroom or Camera Raw, we need to open it in Photoshop as a smart object. The way to do this in Adobe Camera Raw is by holding the Shift key on your keyboard and the Open Image button turns into Open Object. Click on it and your image will open in Photoshop as a smart object. You can tell this by the small icon here on the layer thumbnail, which indicates it's a smart object. And in Lightroom, you can simply right click on your raw image and choose Edit In, and then click on Open in Photoshop as a smart object. The beauty of a smart object is that any edits you do on it is fully readjustable at a later stage. And with the X panel, it gets even easier. Let me give you a quick example in a new duplicate file. With a rectangular marquee tool, I'm going to make a quick selection around the hair and then copy it to a new layer via layer copy and then click on warp. Let's add a bit of volume to the hair and hit enter to finalize. Now, I'm going to click on Warp again, and you see that the mesh doesn't remember the previous nudges I made. Now let me undo this till I get back to the selection. There. So I'm going to copy the selection again to a new layer using Layer Copy, and this time I'm also going to click on Make Smart in order to convert the layer into a smart object, and then hit Warp. Like before, I'll add a bit of volume and hit Enter. So now, when I click on Warp again, it remembers the previous setting since the layer is a smart object, and I can fine-tune it further. Similarly, for our raw image opened as a smart object, I'm going to click on Edit Smart on the panel, and it will open up Camera Raw to make any further changes. Even though our raw image has been exported from Lightroom, smart object edits are only supported in Adobe Camera Raw. Now, let's blend exposures. Instead of making global adjustments to the image with shadow and highlight sliders and calling it a day, we need to make specific adjustments in different areas of our images for exposure, color, and so on. Our first step is to analyze different areas that need correction. For this image, I'm going to add some details back in the highlights in her forehead and arms and brighten up the legs, even from within since the skirt is supposed to be see-through, but it got lost in the shadows because of the low-key lighting setup. So, first for the shadows, I'm going to click on Smart Copy, which duplicates the current smart layer to a new smart layer via copy, and then click on Edit Smart, which will open the Camera Raw window. Now we are working on a duplicate raw image, and all we need to focus on is getting the exposure in the legs just right, and then click OK. You can always fine-tune these adjustments later via the Edit Smart button on the panel. Again, for the highlights, I'll first click on Smart Copy, which creates a new copy of the smart object layer, and then click on Edit Smart. And this time, I'll focus only on the brightest part of the forehead and arm, and reduce the exposure, and click OK. The next step is to create accurate color or luminosity mask. The panel has a very easy way to do that. I'm going to turn off the visibility of the top two layers for a moment. Then, go to the scene mode on the panel, and under the Quick Mask Pro section, since I'm going to select the brightest highlights first, I'll choose one of these Lights Luminosity Mask button and check in the preview if it covers the areas I want. If not, cancel the mask preview and pick another. I can also choose the first Lights button, then go to Refine Mask and move the shadow slider all the way to the highlights end, and I can get the entire luminosity range. But since I know I want the brightest highlights, I can directly start with one of the brighter lights button. Just like standard masks, the white areas are the one that will reveal the layer contents. When I'm done, I can choose to load the mask as curves, hue saturation, or levels, but in this case, I'll go for load as selection. And all the mask preview layers get instantly converted into a selection of the white area from the preview. Now, going back to the darker layer which I adjusted for the highlights, I'll turn on its visibility first and then click on the Create Layer Mask icon. And there, I have a highlights layer mask just like that. If I click on Edit Smart, I can readjust this exposure via Camera Raw and use the layer opacity to reduce the intensity if required. I can also paint white or black in the mask and use the Fade tool to blend my brush stroke further. Now let's bring in some shadow details in the same way. First, I'll hide the visibility of the top layers as I need a shadows mask based on the underlying original layer. Since I need to brighten the entire legs, I'm not going to choose any of the Dark Luminosity Mask button. Usually, for skin, I would use the Skin Mask button from the panel, and with the Black Masking Brush tool, paint rest of her body black to hide it. But it works better when the skin is evenly lit, and in this case, I need a more targeted selection, so I'm going to use Color Range Masking from the panel. Make sure that the Select menu is set to Sample Colors and the Localized Color Clusters is checked. Next, select the Eyedropper tool and click on the legs. To select more area, you can either use the Plus Eyedropper tool or hold the Shift key down, then click and drag over the skin. To remove unwanted areas, use the Minus Eyedropper tool or hold the Alt or Option key. I'm not going to mess with these sliders as they are simply outdated and they don't help at all. And plus, I have a choice of using better masking tools from the panel. I keep the range set to 100% and usually the fuzziness is on 50. I'm going to click OK, and unlike the standard color range, which would have converted everything into a selection, the panel creates a quick mask preview, which you can fine-tune further with the Refine Mask button to increase or decrease the range. First, I'm going to use the Black Masking Brush tool and paint unwanted areas black to hide it. Then, with the Burn Mask tool, paint over the gray areas to make them black. The Burn tool doesn't affect any white areas. And with the Dodge Mask tool, I can boost the whites in the gray areas without affecting the blacks. The White Paint tool, on the other hand, paints everything white. The Fade tool works here as well to blend the intensity of your brush strokes. Once again, I'm going to load this mask as a selection and make these two layers visible first, and then select my shadows layer and click on the layer mask icon below. Now, I can either double click or click on Edit Smart to tweak the exposure. I can also paint white or black in the mask. And use the Fade tool to blend my brushstroke further. If required, use the layer opacity to reduce the intensity. Let's take a look at the before and after. You can even apply this technique to manipulate specific colors from your RAW file by using one of these color masks, then refining it, and so on. This processing technique by far gives the ultimate control over a RAW file compared to any single conversion from any RAW converter, be it Lightroom or Capture One. So I hope you got something new out of this video. Smash that like button if you did, and if you haven't already, make sure to subscribe for our upcoming videos. Until next time, happy retouching!